which is graphs and its transformations. Graphs and its transformations. On your screen, you can see a person, and I'm sure you know him. He is Mr. Albert Einstein, okay? And this great scientist of all time says, one picture is worth a thousand words. And when Mr. Einstein says something, definitely it has to be carrying a lot of weightage. So the reason why I've kept this quotation of Mr. Albert Einstein is because graph is nothing but a picture. And indeed, that picture will tell you a thousand words, or in fact, it will tell you everything about the characteristic of whatever relation it is trying to depict. Okay. So graphs and its transformation, just to highlight, graphs and its transformations, how useful a chapter it is. Now, one thing I would like to tell you here, this is not a direct chapter from your textbooks. Okay, if you, let's say, you know, open a R.D. Sharma book or let's say any other JE book, and if you turn around, you will not find this chapter, you know, as it is. Graph is an integral part of, you know, almost all the chapters of mathematics. If you open, like, mostly 90% of the topics that you open, you will find that there is a presence of graph somewhere. Most of us think that graph is an optional way to solve questions. No. Sometimes it can be the only way to solve questions. Okay. So there are some chapters which are heavily dependent upon you knowing the graph. So if you know the graph, then only you'll be able to solve those chapters. So I'll list down the chapters. I know I will not talk much about them because they are something that you're going to see in your 2 years of study with us. So the very first chapter that we are going to use graphs is relations and functions. Relations and functions. So if you turn your any standard class 11th book, this is normally the second chapter after sets. Relations and functions is a chapter where you will be using graphs to depict relations and a certain type of relations which we call functions. So relations and functions will be the first chapter where you'll be seeing it. Okay. Next, you'll be seeing this in a very, very big chapter called trigonometry. Let me tell you, trigonometry is a huge chapter for you in class 11th. When I say huge, it almost takes me 2 months to complete trigonometry. Okay? Because trigonometry is just not about identities. There are so many things associated. There will be trigonometric equations. There will be properties and solutions of triangles. There would be, you know, a lot of concepts which are basically, you know, based on trigonometry. In class 12th also, you will learn inverse trigonometric functions. So all of them would require you the knowledge of graphs. Okay. Apart from this, just to speak in, you can say, a nutshell, calculus. What is calculus? Calculus is basically a vertical of mathematics where we deal with small changes, or what we call as infinitesimal changes. Okay. Now, this changes happens where? This changes happens in the relationship between two or more variables. So in order to know what is the relationship between the changes in these two variables, you should know how they are linked graphically to each other also. Okay. So calculus, there are several topics. I would not like to name them. Be it limits, be it continuity, be it differentiability, be it area under curves. All of them would require you to know your graph very, very well. Okay, that's the main purpose why I'm picking this chapter. And not to say the least, one of the very interesting chapters called Theory of Equations. Theory of Equations. So where you need to know how many solutions are possible to a certain equation. Okay, graphs can be very, very handy. Almost in, let's say I talk about JE Main and JE Advanced exam, there are almost 60% questions which actually, you know, coming from theory of equations where you can apply graphs. Okay. So with this, I would just begin the chapter. So this is just to tell you the utility of the concept that we are going to study. So these are, this concept of graph and its transformation will be useful in these chapters. Okay. I don't note it, no need to note it down. It's just for your understanding. How important is this chapter for us? So we are going to start with what is a graph, first of all. Okay, let's define graph in a, you know, very, very generic way. What is the meaning of a graph? Can anybody, you know, explain what is the meaning of a graph in your own words? Let it be right, let it be wrong, no problem. Try it out. What do you think is a graph? Ranjini, would you like to try? Representation of data. Very good. Okay. Anybody else? Good try. Riya. So I don't want to name people around. So Adya is there. Arundhati. Avani. Janya. Karthik. Okay. Siddharth. Very good. Okay. In a nutshell, just to define it, graph is nothing but it's a pictorial representation, or you can say a geometrical representation, a pictorial representation of a relation between or a relation among several variables. Okay, so we know in our physical world every quantity is somehow linked to the other, isn't it? Your marks is directly linked to how many hours you are studying, isn't it? The price of food is directly linked to the price of fuel. Okay, so lately you would be hearing of a lot of protests going against the government for increasing the price of the fuel. Why? Because the farmers, they use fuel in operating the machinery for cultivating their crops. And if you increase the price of fuel, obviously the cost incurred by them to cultivate the crop goes high. And if the crop the price to cultivate the crop becomes higher, even the price of the food material that we are consuming will go higher. Correct. So things are linked to each other. Okay. So when several parameters or several variables are linked to each other, to show the pictorial representation of how they are linked, we would require the use of graph. Okay, so this is what I have written, relation. Okay, now for our study in this chapter, graph and its transformation, we will be restricting ourselves only to relation between two variables. Okay, so let's say a variable y is related to a variable x by any relation. Now this relation can be anything. Okay, it could be a polynomial relation, it could be a trigonometric relation, it could be an exponential relation, it could be a logarithmic relation. It could be some special type of relation also. Okay, so we'll come across those relations soon, one by one in our discussion of this chapter. So this basically are two variables which are related to each other. So when you start plotting, or you can say start sketching the x comma y points which are related to each other by this relation, then you obtain the graph of that relation. Okay, then you obtain the graph of that relation. This is very obvious to all of us. Okay, I'll just give you a simple example. To illustrate this. Let's say I have y is equal to x plus 2. Right, we all know that this is a straight line, right? This is the equation of a straight line. So what is happening here? Here, y and x are related to each other. By what relation? That y is always 2 more than x. Okay, so if x is 1, y will be 3. If x is 0, y will be 2. If x is 5, y will be 7. Right? So if you start putting some values of x, let's say 0, then y will automatically become 2. If you put 1, y will become 3. If you put x as 2, y will become 4. Da 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 da. So if you start plotting them, you would obtain the pictorial representation of that relation, which I'm sure all of you know is going to be a straight line like this. Right? Everybody knows it's going to be a straight line. Anybody who doesn't know, even if you don't know, don't worry about it. There is an official chapter called Straight Lines coming your way in class 11. Okay, so let's say it is x and y. Okay, now this relation need not be restricted only to two variables. It can be three variables. For that, we need a 3D graph. Okay. And multiple variables can also be involved. So the dimension of the graph will accordingly increase. Okay. But for our study, we will be restricting ourselves only to show those pictorial representations where only two variables are involved. Now, normally, I'm again stressing on the word normally, the variable which we normally put without thinking anything, we call that as an independent variable. So here, x would be called as an independent variable. Why we call it as an independent variable? Because here, see, while you were choosing x value as 0, 1, 2, did anything govern your choice? No, right? You just picked it up, 0. Chalo, let's put 0, right? Let's put 1, let's put 2, let's put 5, let's put 100. So nothing was governing your choice of the value of x. So that is why that variable is actually called an independent variable, where you are not deciding anything prior to choose the value of that variable. But y value will actually depend upon what you have chosen for x. So this will become a dependent variable. Okay, this will become a dependent variable. Okay, so this is an independent variable. This is a dependent variable because it depends upon what you have chosen for x. Okay, so now many people will say, sir, what if I express x in terms of y? So y will become your independent variable and x will become dependent variable. Okay, so they may change their positions. So it's not a hard and fast rule that, hey, x is always independent and y is always dependent. No, it depends upon the choice of which variable or the choice of the value of which variable is independent. That means you're not basing, you're not, you know, deciding it based on some factor. Okay. So is the definition of a graph clear to you? What's a graph? Any question regarding what's a graph? Any concerns? You can always speak out. You can unmute yourself. You can talk. You can write it on the chat box. Okay. So any mode is fine with me. Okay. So somebody has written something. What if four variables? Yeah, that's a, you know, subject matter that we are. So there are very four dimensions also, right? There are four dimension graphs also available. Okay. So you would be coming across something called quaternions. Quaternions are basically in four dimensions. And those are very much a subject matter of study in the field of cryptography, which is used in the field of computer science, okay, for data encryption. So maths is not close-ended, my dear students. Maths is open-ended. Probably by the time your children or your grandchildren would be studying mathematics, they would be studying a completely different types of topics, which you would not have even heard of, okay? So yes, there can be four variables. There can be multiple variables involved, fine? Very interesting. I'm sure some of you would also be interested in doing some kind of a research work in this field. Okay. All right. So what are we going to learn in this chapter? We are going to learn how to draw the graph of certain well-known relations. Okay. Certain well-known relations. So we'll be starting with polynomial relations, or what we just called polynomials. Okay. So let's start with polynomials. Now, I would like to know from you, since you have studied this in class 10th, and since you are studying it in class 10th, what do you understand from a polynomial? What's a polynomial? Let's hear it out from you. What do you know about polynomial? Yes, anybody? It's an algebraic expression. So any algebraic expression, Arundhati, can qualify to call a polynomial? No? Yes? With at most two zeros? Okay. I'm not saying right or wrong to your response, Adya. But good try. I'm happy to see people trying. See, dear students, let me tell you, I'm a different type of a teacher. I do not judge anybody from the answer that you give. Okay. For me, your answer is your attempt to solve the question. Okay. So as long as you're attempting, I'm happy. But if you keep quiet saying nothing, then you're not doing yourself any good. Okay, so not sure. It's a function of x where x power is whole number. Okay. Algebraic expression with positive whole variable powers. Okay, very good. I'm very happy to see most of you trying your best to solve the question. So a polynomial is basically an expression of this nature, and it could be in any variable. I'm using x for the sake of an illustration over here. So a polynomial is an expression. Mark my words, what I'm trying to say. A polynomial is an expression in a single variable where the exponent of the variable, here it is x, where the exponent of the variable, here it is x, must be a whole number. Yes, some of you have mentioned this in your definition. This is very important. So normally we represent polynomial with P with a bracket where we write down the variable that we have used in writing that expression. So what is it? It's an expression, okay? It's an algebraic expression in a single variable. It cannot have multiple variables. Let me tell you that, okay? A polynomial will only be in a single variable, whether it is x, whether it is t, whether it is u, whether it is w, whatever variable you want to choose. But it should be strictly of this nature. Okay, as you can see, it is strictly of this nature. This should be the format of a polynomial, where these exponents on these variables must all be whole numbers. In fact, if you want, I can write x to the power 0 here for the sake of consistency. They must all be whole numbers. That means under no circumstance, a polynomial should have any other structure than this. And under no circumstance should any exponent on the variable should be fraction or negative integer. Okay, that is strictly prohibited in a polynomial. Now got it, everybody is consistent with the definition. See, why I'm illustrating so much upon it is because tomorrow you guys are going to face KVPY interview, right? And there you would be grilled by, you know, professors who have been in this field for the last 30 years. And let me tell you, these professors are very, very meticulous about the choice of words you make. So when you say something, be very sure about what you are saying. Okay? Many of you use different varieties of, you know, words to explain things which may not be the right description of it. So while you're learning, be very, very careful, right? From pronunciation to whatever expression you are, you know, talking about, be very careful about it. Now, this number that you see in front of x to the power n, okay, this number is actually called LC. Okay, what is LC? LC means leading coefficient. Okay, leading coefficient. So this number, this coefficient is a very important one, and it is called the leading coefficient. Why it is called leading coefficient? For the simple reason that it leads the entire expression. It is the very first, you know, term that you see in that entire expression. But this is on a lighter note, but on a serious note, it is called leading coefficient because this fellow decides the way the graph would be leading, or the way the graph will be heading towards anything. Okay, so that is a very important coefficient which decides which way the graph should be heading towards. So that's a leader, just like a leader leads the way, right? So that leads the way of the graph. Okay, we'll soon realize it when we are trying to plot it. So any question about polynomial? So let me ask you a few questions if you don't have any. So let me ask you this question. Okay, let me not write example. So a few important questions I would like to ask. So tell me, let's say if I write a polynomial, if I write an expression like this, x to the power 5 minus 3x to the power 4 plus 6x minus 1. Is this a polynomial, first of all? Yes. Okay. Then tell me the degree of the polynomial. I hope you know the degree of the polynomial. Just to revise for you, degree of the polynomial is the exponent of, or you can say it is the highest exponent of the variable present in that algebraic expression or present in that polynomial. So absolutely correct. Yes, it is a polynomial. And its degree is 5. Very good. Okay. Let me ask you another question. Let's say P2x is a polynomial given by 1 by x to the power 5 minus 3x to the power 4 plus 6x minus 1. Okay. So I just reciprocated whatever term you saw in P1. Is it a polynomial? Is it a polynomial? Absolutely good. You guys know your stuff. It is not a polynomial because its structure doesn't match with this. Okay. Awesome. Very good. Okay. Next question. Next question. Very simple one. X to the power 3 by 2. Oh, sorry. X to the power 3 plus root 2x plus 1. Now, this root is only on 2. Is it a polynomial? Is it a polynomial? Very good. Yes, it is a polynomial. Actually tried to confuse you with this root 2. Okay, but you guys are smart enough. Okay, try this out. X to the power 5 by 2 minus 3x plus 5. Is this a polynomial? No, it is not. Very good. Why? Because there is a presence of a fractional power on x. That is not a part of a polynomial. Okay. Achha, tell me, what is the degree of, find the degree of the polynomial 6? Simple question. What do you think is the degree of the polynomial 6? Very good. 0, 0. The answer is degree here is 0. Okay, degree here is 0. Okay, let me ask you this. Find the degree of the polynomial 0 itself. 0 itself. Okay, so I'm getting different varieties of answers. Half the janta is saying 0. Half the janta is saying not defined or undefined. Okay, now here is the verdict here. Degree here is undefined. Okay. Why it is undefined? Because you can write 0 as 0x to the power of anything over here. It doesn't matter whether you write 0, 1, 2, 3, 100, 400, 500. So degree for this particular polynomial 0 is not defined. Okay. Remember, you have done a chapter called, and in fact, you are doing a chapter with Dheeraj sir, vectors. There is something called null vector. What is the direction of a null vector? Can anyone tell me what is the direction of a null vector? Undefined. Okay. Its direction is not defined, but it's still a vector. Okay. So you must be wondering, sir, vector should have direction. Okay. Why 0 doesn't have a direction? So these are some special cases you will always find where one of the parameters, which is an integral part of it, will not be defined. So 0 polynomial degree is not defined. Null vector direction is not defined. Later on, you will learn so many things related to it in complex numbers also. Okay. So now that I'm convinced you know your polynomial stuff, we will be starting with the simplest of all polynomials, which is a constant polynomial. Okay. Which is a constant polynomial. So a constant polynomial is basically where you have y equal to c. Okay. Or y equal to some constant. Okay. The c can be a positive, negative number, anything it could be. So this is a constant polynomial. Here you can see that there is no term in x, or if you want to write it, basically all the coefficients in the x are actually 0, right? So if you really want to write it, you can write it as 0x to the power n, 0x to the power n minus 1, da 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 da, and only a constant term c will be left off. Okay, so this is called a constant polynomial. So how would the graph of a constant polynomial look like? Very simple. It just says that it doesn't matter whatever is your x, your y will always be fixed at c. So if you put x as 1, y will be still c. If you put x as 2, y will be still c. If you put x as 100, y will be still c. So it basically says that no matter whatever choice of x you make. Okay, by the way, I forgot to tell you this. We are going to draw these graphs on a plane which we call as the Cartesian plane. Ayo, what is happening? Yeah. So I'm going to draw all these graphs going forward on a plane which I will be calling as the Cartesian plane. Okay. So as you can see, I have drawn two reference lines, x-axis and y-axis, and this plane will be called as a Cartesian plane. Sometimes you also call it as an R-square plane. R square plane. Why it is called R square plane? Let me tell you a few things about it. Basically, this R means real. Okay, so whatever relations we are going to discuss, or whatever graph of relations we are going to discuss, those relations would be all real relations. What is the meaning of real relation in maths? Real relation means you can actually pictorially see the relation. Are you getting my point? That means you can see the point on the graph. So what type of relations we cannot see? Relations which involve complex quantities, those kind of relations you will not be able to see on a real graph. For that, we need something called the non-real graph, or the Gaussian plane. So Gaussian plane, Argand plane, whatever is the name given to it, is something which we will talk little later on, much later on, in fact, when we do complex numbers. But as of now, we will be restricting our discussion only with respect to real quantities of x and real quantities of y. That is why we call such a plane as R square plane, because your X is also real, Y is also real. If you were using three plane reference axes, let's say X, Y, and Z, then that plane would be called, or that 3D plane would be, 3D space would be called as R cube space. Okay, so we'll be restricting only to R square plane for the purpose of our bridge course chapter. Now, can somebody tell me why it is called the Cartesian plane? Why Cartesian plane? Why not just in a simple plane, 2D plane? Anybody knows? After whom it has been named? Scientist guy named Cartesian. Right, Shardili, absolutely. There was a famous French mathematician called René Descartes. Note down the pronunciation. René Descartes. Okay. I know in school and in so many places, people mispronounce this guy name, French mathematician, René Descartes. Okay. So this is a French guy. And he was very instrumental towards his work in analytical geometry. And in order to honor his, honor this guy, this particular R square plane was named as the Cartesian plane. Now, is this only way to represent a point in a plane? Okay, no. There are several other ways to do so. You will be learning many of them in your due course of study. There is one called the polar coordinates, which was given by Newton. And in fact, in your engineering and pure sciences course, you will be coming across furthermore. In fact, there are more than 10 coordinate systems available to represent the position or location of a point in 2D space. Okay, 2D, 3D space. Okay. So now, coming to this particular constant polynomial, as I told you, whatever is the x value, my y value will always be c. Let's say x is 0, y will be c. Now, let's say I'm assuming my, let my c be positive. Okay, some positive quantity. So in your mind, think of c being some positive value. So if your x is 0, y will be c. If your x is 1, y will be c. X is 2, y will be c. X is 3, y will be c. X is minus 1, y will be c. So all of you, by this time, you would have already known that this would be nothing but a parallel line, or you can say a horizontal line, okay, parallel to the x-axis. Okay, so just put arrows at the end of it because it keeps on going. So such a polynomial is basically called a constant polynomial, and graph of a constant polynomial would just be a line parallel to the x-axis. Okay, so depending upon c value, it could either be above the origin. This is the origin, or below the origin. Okay. Now, some people relate this to x equal to constant. Now, this is, what is x equal to constant? X equal to constant, how would this look like? Any idea, anybody? Any idea, anybody? Yeah, everybody, please try. Very good. Ranjini says parallel to y-axis, parallel to y-axis, parallel to y-axis. Okay. Now, I'll try to confuse you a bit. Most of you are saying parallel to y-axis. So let's say my c is positive. I'm just assuming it. Okay. It could be anything, positive, negative. It could be zero also. So my graph of x equal to c would be a line parallel to the y-axis. Absolutely correct. Okay. Now, there was one student who asked me, sir, why x equal to c, won't it be like a make a number line, okay, make a number line for x and just put a point x equal to c. So won't this be the graph of x equal to c? So why are you drawing us a line like this? Won't it be just a point? This is a question to you from my side. How will you answer this? How will you justify that, student? What is happening? Is my question clear to everybody? Won't x equal to c be just a point on the real number line of x? Janta is confused. Okay. So what happens, Shardili? So y equal to 0 for all values of x. y is equal to 0 for all values of x, that is not justified, because here let's say I can have a point of y equal to 1 also. So c comma 1 can be a point on this line. C comma 2 can be there, C comma 3 can be there, C comma minus 1 can be there. Why only C comma 0? Right, Siddharth Karthik has actually given very close to the correct answer. Dear all, the representation of a particular, you can say an equation like this, depends upon how many dimensions you are using to represent it. Okay, so right now I'm just using one dimension. One dimension is used here to represent the point, and for that, this point, this line will actually become a point. See, all of you, just imagine I'm rotating my y-axis like this. I hope, let's say, look at the camera. So let's say this line, this finger of mine is the x-axis, okay? And this marker here is the y-axis, okay? This marker here is the y-axis. Let's say I'm rotating the marker like this, okay? Till the marker goes inside the laptop screen or desktop screen, whatever you are using, okay? So when you rotate your y-axis, let's say inside the plane of this laptop, you would realize that even this line will rotate, and what you will see is like a dot over here. So the reason why you can see a dot in case of a one dimension and a line in case of two dimension is because it depends upon how many dimensions you are using to represent it. Now, most of you would be surprised that what you actually thought to be a line is actually a plane. You don't believe me, no? Okay, I'll show you. Let me just open one of the graphing software that I normally use, GeoGebra. I'll talk about it. GeoGebra 3D, let me show you. Okay. So if I say y equal to x plus 1, I'm sure most of you will say, sir, this is a line, right? Okay. It is a line because you're seeing it in two dimension. The same y equal to x plus 1, if I type it in three dimension, it will actually look like a plane. So I'm showing you y equal to x plus 1 graph on this. All of you please see very carefully. I'm just putting a color to it. Okay, so all of you please note down or please look at this particular graph. If you see y equal to x plus 1, it has plotted a plane for it. See, I'm making it dance around. Do you see it? Okay, it is because, my dear, you're using three dimension to show it. In two dimension, one dimension is always curved. It is always killed. So you only see, for example, let's say if I start seeing it from top. There you go. You see, I'm seeing a line. I see a line out of it. Because the z-axis has been reduced to a point. From top, if you see, z-axis is like a point. See this, you know, blue point over here? So one dimension has completely been eliminated. And that's why you see a line there. But in reality, if you provided it one more dimension, it would have become a plane like this. Okay, so I'm allowing you to rotate for you to get an idea of. Right? Isn't it very interesting? So your representation of a given curve actually depends upon how many dimensions you are exposed to. Isn't it interesting, right? Yeah, it will, x equal to c will also be a plane. Okay, let me show you. Let me go back. So x equal to, let's say, 5. Okay. I hope you can see. Let me just switch off this. Yeah. You see this? It's actually a plane, my dear. So if you allowed one dimension to it, it will be a point. If you allow two dimension to it, it will be a line. If you allow three dimension to it, it will become a plane. Right? So when we start looking at things from a very limited perspective, we always think, we always see from one dimension less, right? That's why we say never, you know, try to judge anything by looking at it from one dimension. Okay, anything, let's say your laptop screen. If you see from the front, you will think that, okay, it is a two-dimensional structure. The moment you start, you know, turning your head here and there, it has got some thickness also. So it's a three-dimensional structure, correct? All right, so several questions I am getting. Vaishnavi says in 2D it becomes a line. Yes, Vaishnav. Setu, what will it be in 4D? Oh my God. Now people are trying to explore more dimensions. So it is our inability to actually, you know, imagine something in 4D, but I will definitely leave it up to your, research work to figure it out. Okay. Okay. So no, cube is also a three-dimensional structure, my dear friend. So in 4D, 5D, in multiple Ds, it's up to your imagination to think it out, because it's very difficult to represent those things. Okay. Anyways, so with this, one thing is clear, that y equal to constant is like a horizontal line if there is two dimension. Okay. And if you are using only one real number line for y, it will be like a point on it. And x equal to a constant is a vertical line parallel to the y-axis. And again, if you're using only one number line to represent it, it will be just like a point on it. Okay. All right. So let's have a small question based on this. 4D, what is 4D? What is the fourth dimension that you're trying to take? It all depends on that, no? Okay. So if you're trying to represent a position of something in terms of time, okay, then probably 4D will be your time. But how will it look like in 4D is something very difficult to, you know, comment right now. Okay. All right, let's have a question on this. Let's not digress on that topic, because there are so many things that we can actually explore ourselves also. So here is a very small question, okay? And I will put a poll for this, okay? You need to choose the right option from the poll. Okay, here is the poll. You only have 30 seconds to answer this. Question is, which of the following is the graph of y equal to minus 3? On your screen, you would be seeing, you know, cross lines, which are actually your coordinate axes. And the actual graph will be slightly solid and it won't have numbering on it. Okay, I'm getting the response. Very good. Just now we did this very small question based on those that concept. Y equal to negative 3, my dear. Very good. So in case you are not able to see the poll on your screen, you can always put your response on the chat box. Even that is fine for me. But if you're watching it on a mobile phone, please let me discourage you from doing it, because the moment the poll is launched, it will block your whole screen. Okay, so please do not watch out these classes on a mobile phone. Better to have a desktop, laptop, okay? All right, so at the count of five, we'll stop. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Let's go, let's go. Three people are waiting for my instructions. Okay, anyways, let's stop. So most of you, 79% of you said option B. And let me tell you, my dear students, B is absolutely correct. B is absolutely correct. Okay. So y equal to something, as you know, it's a horizontal line. Okay. Minus 3 means it should pass through minus 3 comma 0. It should pass through 0 comma minus 3. So 0 comma minus 3 is only happening in B. It is not happening in A, C, and D. Okay. By the way, just to add on, this would represent which graph? Graph of which equation? Y equal to 3. Yes. This would be x equal to 3. This would be x equal to minus 3. Okay. We will talk more about it in our discussion of straight lines, which is going to happen in a couple of months' time after your board exam is over. Okay. Very good. Now we'll quickly move on to linear polynomials. Linear polynomial graph. Okay. Linear polynomial basically is a polynomial where you have the highest exponent of the variable only as 1. So ax plus b type. So normally we plot the value of this whole thing, or we plot the value of p of x along y axis. Hence we can also write it like this. Okay. By the way, it is stupidity to write 1. So we will discourage writing 1 over there. So this kind of a polynomial will be called as a linear polynomial. Why it is called a linear polynomial? Because the graph of it comes out to be a line in two dimension. Again, please be very careful. Line in two dimension. Okay. But actually speaking, it's a plane. Okay. As we already discussed a little bit. Okay. Line in 2D. Yes, absolutely. Now, how do we sketch the graph, or how do we make the graph for such kind of a polynomial? Now, if you put your x value as zero, if you put your x value as zero, you know that the value of y will be equal to b. Okay, so if you put x as zero, your y will actually be b. Okay, that means this particular graph that you're going to sketch. Acha, what is the difference between plot and sketch? What sir, English questions you are asking in a maths class? Eh? What is the difference between plot and sketch? Very good, Vaishnav. Okay, so plot is an exact representation of the graph. Sketch is a rough, you know, representation of the graph, right? So when we say, sketch this portrait or sketch this scenery, you do not sketch it like, you know, point by point. Okay, you just make a rough idea or rough visual representation of that particular scenery, right? So that is called the sketch. So when the question says sketch means roughly, okay, plot means you need a graph paper for that because you need to do it point by point. Okay, anyways, so how will you sketch this? So one thing is very clear that whatever line we are going to get, that line is going to pass through 0 comma b. So let's say I consider b to be my positive value, so it will pass through 0 comma b. Okay, so this point 0 comma b. Now how will it pass? How will it pass? Will it pass like this? Will it pass like this? Will it pass like this? How do I know? How do I know? How will it pass? Will it be option A? Will it be option B? Will it be option C? So from this particular expression, how do we come to know about it? Okay. So let's discuss it through an example. Let us say I want to plot the graph of y equal to 3x plus 2. Okay. So this point is 0 comma 2. Fine. That is absolutely fine with everybody. Now, what role this guy 3 plays in deciding what type of graph will this line have? Okay. Now, we have already seen that when it was a constant polynomial, it was parallel to the x-axis. So A cannot be my option because A is basically meant for constant polynomials, correct? But this is not a constant polynomial. It has got 3x term also with it. Okay. Now, whether it is B or whether it is C, how do we figure that out? Okay. Now, let's analyze it through a simple logical, logical move. So let us say whether B or C, A is completely out of the picture. So let me remove it also because I don't want to keep this even in my options. So I have to decide between B and C. Okay. So let's say I take a point on this particular line, x1, y1. Okay. And I take another point on this line, x2, y2. Okay. So what I do, I take two points on this line, x1, y1 and x2, y2. So let's say these are points on this line. Let's say I call it as 1. Okay. So it's very obvious that they will both satisfy, these two points will satisfy this line. So y1 will be equal to 3x1 plus 2 and y2 will be 3x2 plus 2. Correct? Everybody happy with whatever I have done so far? Any question, any concern, please raise the alarm. Okay, no problem, anybody? Okay. Now let us say x2 is obtained by adding a change of delta x in x1. Okay, let's say the difference between x2 and x1 is delta x. Now, as you all know, delta x is used to represent a change in x. If you don't know it, then start making these kind of notes in somewhere that delta x or delta of anything means a change in that particular quantity. I'm sure you would have done in physics also. What is velocity of a body? Delta s by delta t, right? Change in displacement by change in time, right? So delta s means change in that particular quantity. So here, let's say x2 minus x1 is delta x, or so as to say x2 is x1 plus delta x. Okay, let me just do the same for y2 also. So let's say y2 is y1 plus delta y. Now let us try to understand it on this graph. Now, as of now, I do not know which is my answer. Whether it is B or whether it is C, I do not know. So let's say I take you know, B to be one of my cases, and I take a point here, x1, y1, okay? And I take another point here, x2, y2. So delta x means, what change did you see when you are going from x1 to x2? So this guy is your delta x, okay? And delta y is what change in y happened when you went from y1 to y2. This is delta y. Now, I have no intention in taking delta x as positive or negative. I do not know the sign of it right now. It may be negative quantity, right? Y, if x2, y2 were, let's say, on the other side of x1, y1, then probably my delta x would be negative, delta y would also be negative. As of now, I do not know what is the sign of delta x and delta y. So I do not know which is my answer also, whether it is B or whether it is C, I do not know. Okay, so we are trying to figure that out. So just I have taken two points, x1, y1, x2, y2, on that line, which is supposed to be my answer. And these two points, x1, y1, and x2, y2, are basically related to each other by this relation. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to change this y2 with y1 plus delta y, and I'm going to change this x2 with x1 plus delta x. Okay, this two I'm keeping as such. So what I did, I changed my y2 like this, I changed my x2 like this, and my two remains two over here. Okay, any questions so far? Absolutely, an infinite number of lines can pass through it. So that's why, Siddharth, we are trying to decide what line is possible. Okay, I agree to you. Through 0 comma b, infinitely many lines can pass. What is my attempt here? My attempt here is to figure out which line will it be that will be satisfying this given equation, y equal to 3x plus 2. Wait. Let the discussion be over, Siddharth. Then you can ask your question. So now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to replace this y1 again with 3x1 plus 2. Let delta y be delta y. And this is again, if you open it, it will become 3x1 plus 3 delta x plus 2. Okay. So 3x1 cancels out. 2 cancels out. That leaves me with delta y is equal to 3 delta x. Okay. That means your delta y by delta x actually becomes a 3. Now, this is a very important piece of information for us. How it is very important? Let us see. It says that if you move between a point x1 to x2, sorry, if you move between a point x1, y1 to x2, y2, the change in the y with respect to change in the x should be 3. That means change in the y is 3 times the change in the x. Okay. Now, let us come back to this given pictorial representation. If I go from x1, y1 to x2, y2 such that the change in delta x is, let's say, 1 unit, then the change in delta y should actually be 3 units. And that is happening only in B. That is not happening in C. Why does not happening in C? Because let's say I move from this point x1, y1 to this point x2, y2, let's say 1 unit, then here there is a drop in the value of y. Probably this would be minus 3 units. Okay, so C cannot be my answer. Are you getting my point? So this tells you that, first of all, the ratio of the change in y to the change in x is a positive quantity. Means, if you increase your x, there would be an increase in y. Correct? So that the ratio is still positive. If you decrease your x, there will be a decrease in y. So that the ratio is still positive. And what is the magnitude of this ratio? The magnitude of this ratio is 3 is to 1. 3 is to 1 means if I move 1 kilometers along, let's say, the x-axis, I should reach a point which is 3 kilometers on the y-axis. Means the change in the y should be 3 times the change in the x. And that is only happening in case of B. So, just to answer your question, Siddharth, you will end up making that line through 0, comma B, where if you move from one point to the other on that line, the change in the y that should happen, normally we call this as rise, we call this as run. Okay, I'm sure you would have heard of this term in your straight lines chapter. So the ratio of the rise to the run should be 3. So is that happening in C? Definitely not. So if I move 1 kilometers in this direction, I actually fall by 3 kilometers down. It is not a plus 3 change, or you can say it is not a positive change. It is a negative change. So dear all, welcome to coordinate geometry. In coordinate geometry, your distances will be directed distances. What is the meaning of directed distances? That means they would have a sign. So if I'm moving in this way along the x-axis, positive x-axis, that would be a positive distance. If I'm moving in the negative x-axis, it will be a negative distance for me. If I'm moving down, it is negative. If I'm moving up, it is positive. So in which of the two cases, when I'm moving one in a positive direction, there is a rise of 3 or there is an increment of 3 in the positive y-axis, it is only happening in B, not in C. Right? And no line can actually, they cannot be multiple lines stating the same. Siddharth, just to answer your question, can there be multiple lines satisfying the same criteria? So you said there can be infinitely many lines doing it, right? No, there can only be one line doing it. Okay, so there can only be one line which passes through, let's say 0, 2, and it is such that if I move between any two points, the ratio of rise to run will be 3. So in that case, that line is only the line B. By the way, later on we will learn that this particular term is actually called, this ratio is actually called, or the rise by run is actually called the slope of the line, okay, or the gradient of the line. Okay, so now what is the moral of this entire discussion? The moral of this entire discussion is, just to summarize, if you have been given a linear polynomial like this, okay, so first this decides the y-intercept. Y-intercept means where it is cutting the y-axis. Okay, so y-intercept would be 0, b in this case. Okay, so first make sure your point is cutting the y-axis at 0, b. Okay, now this A, if it is positive, that means your line will be oriented in such a way, your line will be oriented in such a way that the ratio of the change in y to change in x as you move between any two points should be a positive quantity. Now, depending upon the magnitude of that quantity, this can actually become more steeper. Okay, I'm just drawing few cases of, okay. So depending upon its magnitude, it can become steeper, but it will always be oriented in this fashion. Please note down the orientation of it. Please note down the orientation of this line. You can think as if it is coming from left down to right up, even though there is no direction of the line. So you can think it to be oriented in the direction left down to right up. Okay. And if your A is negative, then your orientation of the line would be like this. Your orientation of the line would be somewhat like this. Okay. And depending upon what is the magnitude, it can become either more negatively sloped or less negatively sloped. Is it giving you a clear-cut idea? How do we actually figure out how to sketch the graph of a line depending upon my A and B values? Okay. Let's take a few examples to understand it a little further. Okay, Arundhati, very good. So let's take one simple example. Let's say somebody says, sketch y is equal to -2x - 3. Okay, so everybody first write on your respective notebooks, then we'll discuss it. I'm giving you 40 seconds for it. Rough. I do not want an exact sketch. Okay, so in class 11th and 12th, nobody will give you a graph sheet for making it. So it's just a rough sketch that you should be knowing. Done, everybody? Just write done if you're done. Okay, good. 3 people are done. Done. Okay. So let's analyze this. So first thing that you would see is this -3. This -3 tells you that the graph is passing through 0, -3. So whatever line you're going to get, that line has to cross 0, -3 for sure. Okay. Now this minus 2 tells you that it's a negatively sloped line. Negatively sloped line means that ratio of rise to run should be negative 2. What is the meaning of negative 2? Let's understand it once again. It means that if you go 1 unit along the positive x direction, you should drop by 2 units. Drop by 2 units because there's a minus sign. Are you getting my point? Or other way to understand it, if you move 1 unit towards the negative x axis, you should rise by 2 units. So when can this happen? This can only happen, my dear friends, when your graph is oriented like this. Okay, so let's say I choose this point and start moving 1 unit to the right. Okay, if I move 1 unit to the right, see, I am dropping by 2 units. And this is just a sketch, so I'm just assuming this is 2. Are you getting my point? If I start going 1 unit to the left, let's say, then I will rise by 2 units. So this is a rise in 2. So this is the way your graph will be oriented. Okay, make sure you put arrows at the end. Okay, so any question regarding how do we actually figure out the graph of a linear polynomial depending upon the constants given to us? So this minus 2, as you can see, it actually leads the way of the graph. It actually changes the whole orientation of the graph. Okay, let's have one or two questions. So here is a question coming your way. Which of the following is the graph of minus half x plus 3? Which of the following is the graph of minus half x plus 3? Your pole is right there in front of your screen. Pole is on. Easy question, easy guys, easy. What is this straight line doing over here? Very good. Almost 10 of you, 11 of you, 12 of you have responded. Very good. Others, I will be giving you 20 more seconds, dear. Let's finish it off. Simple question. You can take a hint from these numbers, the markings on the X and the Y. So normally I've not shown which is X, which is Y, but it is very obvious. This is X, this is Y kind of a thing. Okay. All right. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. Almost 60% people say option number C, C for Chennai. Okay, let's check. See, first of all, this number 3 tells you that the graph should cut the y-axis at 0, 3. So in option A and B, it doesn't happen. Only in C and D it is happening when it is cutting it at 0, 3. Correct? Yes or no? So A and B cannot happen. Okay. Now, minus half tells you that the graph has a negative slope. That means ratio of rise to run, is negative half. Negative half, what does it mean? It means if you go 2 units along the positive x, you should drop by 1 unit on the y. Right? So in which of options C and D happens? Let's say I start my journey from here. I move 2 units along the positive x axis. Am I dropping by 1? Seems to be so, because I think let's see the ratio. So let's say I start from here, okay, and I move 6 units, I'm dropping by 3. Yes, so C is my right answer. Obviously D cannot be, because in D, if I'm moving, let's say, 2 units along the positive x-axis, I'm going 1 unit up. That means the ratio of rise to run is 1:2, not -1:2. Yes, I'll repeat once again, Setu. See, this says that if I move 2 units along positive x-axis, okay, I should drop by, my camera is coming in between. I should drop by 1 unit along the y-axis. Okay, along the y-axis. So Setu, tell me in which option it is happening. Is it happening in D? Is it happening in D? No, because when I move two units like this, the line takes me up. Okay, so to reach another point on the line, I have to go one unit up. Yes or no? So it is only happening in C option when I'm moving two units to the right and I have to fall down by one unit to hit the line. Are you getting my point here? What does minus half indicate? It tells you the ratio of rise to run. Minus sign just tells you whether there is a drop or whether there is an increment. Okay, so negative sign, as I told you, it actually tells you the direction. Minus one means one unit down. Got the point? Okay, so now you may say, sir, what if I move two units to the left? That means this same thing can be written as 1:-2. So if I move two units left, I should go up by one unit. Is it happening in D? No, it is happening in C only. C is my answer. Got the point? Okay. I will have one more question because some of you made mistakes. So let's have one more question, just a small one. Which of the following is the graph of 2x minus 3? I'm sure everybody would get this correct. 100% correct answer I would get. I'm launching the poll now. Y is equal to 2x minus 3. Multiple answers people are giving means some of you may be not correct. Okay, Shardali, very good. In case you're not able to see the poll, you can always put your response on the chat. People are giving wrong responses. Okay, last 20 seconds. 20 seconds, last 20 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Everybody, please vote, please vote. Two of you are still waiting for my instructions. Okay, never mind. So I got 89% of the votes out of it. 76% people say option number D. Okay, D for Delhi. And two people have voted for A and B. Okay, again, let's start our analysis with this number minus 3. Okay, this number minus 3 says it should cut the y-axis at 0, -3. So 0, -3 is only happening in B and in D. So A and C are out of the picture. They cannot be my answer. Is that fine, everybody? Okay. Now look at this number 2. 2 says the ratio of rise to run is 2. Okay. 2 means 2 by 1. 2 can be written as 2 by 1. That means if I move one unit along the positive x, I should go up by 2 units. Okay. So in option B and D, where is it happening? Let's say if I move 2 units here, I have to fall down to reach. Okay, so this ratio is -2:1 actually. Are you getting my point? So in option D, if I move one unit here, then only I have to go up by 2 units to hit the line. So option number D is my right option, not B. So Janta, thumbs up to you. You are absolutely correct. Sir, what is this Janta, sir? See, Janta is normally a lingo that we use in IITs. So I come from IIT Kharagpur. So there we normally use Janta for addressing people. Okay, so don't get me wrong. Sir, how do we know we are going? Are Setu, when you hit the line, you have to go up or down, you just try to figure it out. Let's say if I look at B, if I move one unit, in order to hit the line, I have to go up or down. Setu, this is a question for you. If I move one unit to the right, let's say along the positive x-axis, and if you want to immediately come and hit the line from there, you have to go down from there, right? So when you go down, means there is a drop. So it's like your x1, y1 point and x2, y2 point. Correct? So your delta x, this is what is delta x, this is what is your delta y. So here in this case, your delta y by delta x is actually -2/1, right? which doesn't match with this. It says plus 2 by 1. Okay, so that is happening in option D. Now that point is clear, Setu? Okay, good. So please keep asking your doubts. So we will now move our discussion to quadratic polynomials. Polynomials. Okay. So from degree 0, that is constant, we went to degree 1. Now we are going to degree 2. So Srijani has a question. Sir, if it was x equal to 2y minus 3, would it be minus 3 comma 0? It's very obvious, Srijani. So if you put minus 3 comma 0, does it satisfy your equation? Very simple. Let's say if I put my y as 0, does my x come out to be minus 3? Yes, it does come out. So it will pass through minus 3 comma 0. Absolutely right. Okay. All right. Now, quadratic polynomial. What's a quadratic polynomial? So any polynomial where the highest exponent on the variable is 2. Okay. That means your a cannot be 0, because if a is 0, then the highest exponent becomes 1 and not 2. Okay. So such kind of an expression, okay, is called a quadratic polynomial. Okay. So we will replace our p of x with y, actually, because we draw p of x along the y axis. So this kind of a polynomial is called a quadratic polynomial. Now, please do not get confused between quadratic polynomial and quadratic equations. Okay, they are different things. The other day, I'll tell you a story of very, very interesting story, because this is a mistake which many people do. I asked one of the, I was interviewing some teachers in one of the NPS schools, and I asked the teacher that draw the graph of this. Okay. Draw the graph of this. I just gave a question like this. Draw a graph of this. Now, let's say you are the teacher. What would you do? I'm sure you are exposed to quadratic polynomials and quadratic equations both in class 10th, right? Okay, so what will you do? Very good, Sharduli. And I want to see other people's response. Okay, Prisham. Am I pronouncing your name correctly? Prisham, right? Okay. Good. Okay, so let me tell you the zeros of this polynomial, or in fact, the roots of this quadratic. Now, I'm using two words, zeros and roots. So you should be knowing when to use the word zero and when to use the word roots. Right now, it's an equation. So its equation will have roots, and those roots will be 2 and 3. Okay, then what? Okay, now some of you have done mistake while telling me the answer. You have told me it's going to be a parabola. Okay, and a parabola, which is basically cutting the x-axis at 2 and 3. Okay. Let me tell you, this is a wrong answer. Why is it a wrong answer? Again, here your basic concept is being tested. I never gave you to plot y is equal to x square minus 5x plus 6. Right? What did I give you to plot? I gave you to plot this particular equation. Okay. This equation is just corresponding to two points, 2 and 3. There is no y here. Are you getting my point? There is no y over here. So if at all you are using a y, it will be like two parallel lines like this. X equal to 2 and x equal to 3. Are you getting my point? Okay. And let's say if you're not using y, it will be just a number line which will show you the position of two points, 2 and 3. That's it. You just have to make a presentation of two points. Are you getting this? Don't worry. Even teachers are making this mistake, my dear students. She made a parabola, actually, Shardili. Okay. So don't get confused. This is where your KBPY interviewers will, you know, catch you off guard. Okay. This graph is a parabola. I agree. But this graph is either this or this, depending upon how many dimensions you are choosing to represent it. Are you getting my point? Very small things, my dear, but people do not take cognizance of these things. And as a result, blunders happen. Okay. Anyways, coming back to our discussion. All right. So now, just to give you an idea, there are two types of quadratic that we normally deal with. There is something called pure quadratic. Pure quadratic. In pure quadratic, your A is definitely not zero and your B is zero. Okay. And C could be any real number. Okay. It could be zero, it could be non-zero, but B is definitely zero for a pure quadratic. For example, something like this. This is a pure quadratic expression. Okay. So B is zero. Obviously, A cannot be zero because if A is zero, it will no longer be a quadratic. It will actually become linear or a constant depending upon B. Okay. And there's something called adfected quadratic. Adfected quadratic. This is for your, you know, general knowledge. There's nothing like, you know, very hard and fast. So, oh my God, what is this adfected and all? I've never heard of it. Don't worry too much about it. It's just for your knowledge. In adfected, A and B cannot be zero. C can be zero or non-zero quantity. So I'm just writing it as a real number. So a simple expression for adfected quadratic is anything like 2x squared plus 3x plus 2. Okay. This is an adfected quadratic. Just for you to know the name. So that when you start attending your school and your teacher says, hey, there's a pure quadratic. Then you should know, oh yes, in centum, Akhil sir told about it. Okay. Or this is an adfected quadratic. Okay, fine. Now, we are talking about graphs. So let's talk about graphs only. So can anybody tell me, in a quadratic expression, what role does A play in deciding the graph? We all know it's a parabola. Is there anybody who doesn't know it's a parabola? By the way, pronunciation is parabola. I have seen people pronouncing it as parabola and all those things. Not parabola and all, it's parabola. Okay. Parabola is basically a path traced by an object when it travels under gravity. So let's say if I toss a piece of stone at you, it will trace a parabolic path. Okay. Yeah. So my question to all of you is, how are these coefficients A, B, and C going to affect the nature of that parabola? Can anybody, you know, tell me about that? If you have studied about it. Okay. So Prisham says upward, downward. Vaishnav also says opening of the parabola, A governs the opening of the parabola. I'm sure we are talking about A. So, once again, there was a question, sir. Can you show a question on adfected? Is that what you meant, Setu? Example you wanted? I gave an example, dear. That example, no? 2x squared plus 3x plus 2, it's an adfected quadratic. Oh, I didn't know. I'll write it down for you here instead of going back. This is an example of an adfected quadratic plus x minus 5. Okay, this is an adfected quadratic. Okay, so Sharduli will come to C a little later on, dear. Let's talk about A first. What role does A play in deciding the graph of the quadratic polynomial? So for that, I will take you to a tool which is called the GeoGebra tool. By the way, I did not tell you this in the beginning of the class. There are graphing tools that we are going to use. So please make a note of it. So there are two graphing tools that we are going to use. One is GeoGebra. Okay. And this GeoGebra is very, very, you can say, robust graphing tool. And it's an open software. Many of the mathematicians and coders are contributing to it. It's an open license software. So you can always download it. I would request you to download the latest version. I think it's Classic 6. Okay. GeoGebra Classic 6. You can get it from GeoGebra.org. You can download it from GeoGebra.org. So some of you who were already Centum students before, you would be knowing it because Mr. Tushar uses it very, very frequently. So this is normally useful for your desktop. Okay. So desktop or laptop, whatever you are using for the classes, it is good for that. The second software that I normally recommend is Desmos. D-E-S-M-O-S, Desmos. Okay. You can get it for your phone. Okay, so whatever mobile phones you're using, you can download Desmos on your phone so that let's say tomorrow we are meeting in an offline mode and we do not have these laptops and desktops in front of us, we can always open it on our phone and plot the required graph. So today itself, you download it. I think in Google Play Store, you will find it. Okay, and Apple Store also, it should be available. So Desmos and GeoGebra is what we recommend for graphing purposes. Do not try to install GeoGebra on your phone because it's a heavy software. Your phone may get hung up. So do not use GeoGebra for your phone. Best is Desmos for your phone. And for your laptop you use or desktop you use, GeoGebra. So I'll show you my screen where I'll show you my GeoGebra. Yeah, so I have already downloaded. I normally use a Mac. So I have installed it. As you can see here, this is the app. This is the logo of the app, GeoGebra Classic 6. Okay. You can use it online also, but online normally becomes slow sometimes. So if you have the app on your system, the performance is much faster. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to just draw a generic, quadratic polynomial over here. So y is equal to ax square plus bx plus c. Okay. Now, what does this software actually do? See, if you see, I plotted ax square plus bx plus c. I never told the tool what is a, b, and c value. So the moment I write ax square plus bx plus c, this tool comes to know that the user is not sure about the value of a, b, and c. Okay, so it gives me a leeway to choose from. It gives me some liberty to choose, in the value of a, b, and c. So as you can see, it says that you can choose anywhere from -5 to 5 for a, b, and c respectively. And it uses one of the values to actually plot this graph. So as you can see, right now it has used 1 for A. I'll show you on the screen here. It has used 1 for A, 1 for B, and 1 for C as of now. But at the same time, it knows that I am not very sure about A, B, C values as of now. So it gives me an option from -5 to 5 to choose from. Okay. It says, go and choose any value from -5 to 5. Now, if I play with my A, how would this graph change is what we are going to discuss now. So most of you said it depends. It basically tells you where the graph opens. Now the correct word is actually, A decides the concavity of this parabola. Concavity means how much are the arms bend? Yes, right? How much motu patlu it can become, okay? So it depends. It also decides that factor as well. Okay, so let's see. Right now A is at 1. So I'll increase it, towards 5. So let's say I go to higher value. If you see, as I'm going to a higher value, 2.5, 2.7, 2.9, 3.2, 3.3, till 5. Okay, let's say this allows me to go to 5. It starts shrinking. Okay, so it is changing the concavity of the graph. That's the word, Vaishnav. Concavity. I'll write it down for you over here. So A decides the concavity of the parabolic curve. How much concave it is. Okay. Similarly, if I start taking my A, towards negative side, let's say I bring it back to 1. Okay. Now all of you please pay attention from here on. Now I'm going slowly towards 0. Do you see the graph is becoming fatter? Do you see that? Fatter, 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 and near to 1, it actually, not near to 1, exactly to, sorry, near to 0, it actually loses its quadratic nature. It actually becomes a linear graph. As you can see, it becomes a line, x plus 1, correct? Now, what happens if I take it further to the negative side? If I take it to the further to the negative side, as you can see, it has made a bent downwards. Means earlier it was concave upwards, now it has become concave downwards. Are you getting my point? So A basically governs the concavity of the curve. So what did we learn in this entire exercise? Let me plot it down over here. So if A is a positive quantity, the graph, the parabola actually opens upward. Opens upward. Okay. The mathematical term for it is concave upward, but I don't want you to get confused in the concave word right now. It opens upward. And if you increase your value further, the parabola becomes thinner. Okay, the parabola becomes thinner, or you can say it shrinks along the y-axis, or you can say along the x-axis. Okay, so it shrinks along the x-axis. Getting the point? So if a is positive, it will open upward, and if it is a very high positive value, the higher the value of a, the more shrunk the parabola will become along the x-axis. Are you getting my point? Okay, so just to give you an idea, just a small question for all of you. Okay, if let's say this is the graph of y is equal to x square. Okay, actually it will be, passing through origin over here. Y equal to x square. Okay, now tell me which of the following will be the graph of y equal to x square by 2. So let's say this is one option, let's say option number A. And another option, I'll put it in, let's say, blue color. Okay, so out of option A and B, which of them is the graph of y equal to x square by 2? Just say A or B on your chat box. A or B, which option? Brilliant, guys. Very good. I think almost everybody, apart from I think few of them, they have given the incorrect answer. Yes, the answer is option number A. Okay, because you are multiplying it with half. Okay, so y equal to x square is like y equal to 1 into x square. So you are reducing your leading coefficient from 1 to half. So it will open up more. It will become flatter. It will become fatter. So when it becomes fatter, it can only be option A, not B. Got the point? B probably could be the graph of y equal to 2x square. Okay, I'm just taking some random example. And if A is negative, as you could see from your GeoGebra, if A is negative, your parabola would open downwards. Your parabola will open downwards. It's a downward opening parabola. And again, the same, if you keep increasing the magnitude of A, it will become thinner. Magnitude only. So let's say I want to just give you a comparison. Let's say I have y equal to negative x square like this. Okay, let's say this is y is equal to negative x square. Okay, and if I want to plot the graph of y is equal to negative 2x square, it will be downward opening only, but it will be thinner like this. Okay, I hope you can figure it out. Is this fine? Is this idea clear? Okay. All right. Now going back to the GeoGebra, A role is very much obvious to us. Tell me, how does B influence the nature of this graph? Can anybody tell about how B influences the nature of this graph? A is pretty clear, right? A, no problem. Now my question is, how does B change the nature of this graph? Anybody? Any guesses? So if I change my B, if I play with my B, what will happen to this graph? Any idea? Okay, some people are saying open left, right, move laterally, maybe it goes side to side. Okay, good. Most of you have tried your best, but let me tell you, its motion is a parabolic motion. Okay, it will move if you put your A and C fixed, and if you change your B, this entire parabola will actually dance on a parabola. Okay, let me show you. By the way, I forgot to tell you, the lowest point of this parabola is actually called the vertex. Okay, I hope everybody knows it. Okay, vertex of the parabola. Now, let me show you how does the vertex dance when this B value is changed. Thankfully, in case of GeoGebra, you can always locate the vertex of any parabola by using this command vertex. And in place of this input, you have to give the conic, which is basically involved over here, which is f. Okay. So as you can see, the moment I write vertex bracket and the name of the conic, which is f in this case, it automatically points towards the vertex position, which is a in this case. Now, all of you, please watch. I am now making my B change. Okay, so I'm playing with my B. Do you see what is happening to the parabola? Okay, at least you're seeing what is happening to the vertex. What do you see? You see that your parabola is self dancing on a parabola. Okay, you know, why does it happen? Why does it happen? And let me give you a question based on this a little later on. See, all of you, it will not be exactly mirror image. I'll tell you what is it, Shardili. Okay, see, I'm sure all of you would have learned that your vertex coordinate is minus b by 2a comma minus d by 4a. I hope everybody remembers this, where d is the discriminant of the parabola. Anybody who doesn't know this formula? Was there anybody in this class who was not aware of the vertex coordinates of a parabola? I'm sure everybody knows it, right? And this is important for your board exam. Oh, you didn't know? Okay, no problem. No problem. Now you know that. Okay. We will derive it officially also when we are doing the chapter quadratic equations, complex numbers and quadratic equations in class 11. Oh, no wonder. They deleted it this year. Achha, achha. Okay. They should not have done this. You know why? Because quadratic equation comes in at so many places in 11th and 12th. You cannot do without quadratic equation. Okay. That's the most, in fact, quadratic polynomials are the most commonly seen polynomials while you are solving math questions. Anyways, never mind. So vertex coordinate. So basically, if you have a quadratic polynomial like this, the vertex coordinate is given by minus b by 2a comma minus d by 4a. Setu, I didn't get your question. Can you show the shrinking again for negative? I didn't get your point. Which negative, my dear? For negative a value. Acha, can you just wait for some time? Once I'm done with the discussion of this, can I go back? Okay, thanks, Setu. So now see here. As you can see, the vertex has b in it, right? In fact, d also has a b in it. So if I write it properly, it is minus b by 2a. And this term is actually 4ac minus b square by 2a. Oh, sorry, 4a. Okay. So if you keep your a and c fixed, that means a and c are not changing. Only b is changing. As you can see, this is changing and this is changing. As a result, both the x and the y coordinates of the vertex is changing. And because they are changing, this parabola's vertex will start dancing on another curve, which actually you can see is another parabola. Okay? Are you getting what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to say here that if you keep your A and C fixed, A and C, you are keeping it fixed. Fixed means you are not changing its value. But if you are varying your B, what will happen? B is involved over here. B is also involved in D. So as a result, the vertex starts moving. When the vertex moves, it moves in such a fashion that it is always on a curve, which happens to be this dotted line, as you can see over here. Okay. Now, it is very easy to figure it out that it is also another parabola. Okay. And now my question here comes for all of you. Okay. Try this out for homework. Yes, Shardili, I'm going to ask that question. What is the equation of this parabola? This is a homework question for all of you. Just to tell you, Shardili, that is not correct answer. By the way, your answer will only be in terms of A and C. So the answer will be in terms of, answer is in terms of A and C only. Okay, because B is changing, right? So B and B cannot appear in your answer. So give me the equation of this parabola in terms of A and C only. Of course, X and Y will be there. That goes without saying also. Okay. So try this out for homework. Try this out for homework. In case you're not, Setu has got it. Well done, Setu. Okay, don't tell your answer to anybody. Okay. Let not people, you know, call you and ask you, hey, what was the answer? What was the answer? Okay. So everybody, please give it an honest try. And feel free to, you know, send me your workings personally to me. Okay. Try it out, Rational. Try it out. Okay. So question is, I'll again repeat my question. Question is, there is a quadratic expression where A and C are fixed and B is basically changed. Okay. What is the path which is traced by the vertex, or what is the equation of the path which is traced by the vertex of this parabola? Your answer should be in terms of A and C. Okay, try it out. One of you have actually given the answer. Good. Okay. Now, so B role is clear to everybody. Now, what about C role? What about C role? If I change my C, what happens to the parabola? Anybody? What happens to the parabola if I change my C values? How will it dance? Left, right, up, down, or goes in a very complicated path? Very good, Prisham. It goes up and down. As you can see here, I'm just making the change in the value of C. Just watch the motion of this graph. It goes up and down. In fact, vertex, you can see it is tracing a straight line. Okay. Guys, why am I telling you all these things? Why am I telling you all these things? Of course, yes, Sharduli, the point where it is cutting the y-axis keeps changing. So as a result, the point keeps going up and down. Now, why I'm telling you all these things is because they are the formative part of your understanding of transformations. So very soon we are going to talk about some transformations. As of now, we are just talking about graph. No transformation was discussed so far. But I'm going to talk about transformations, which is going to be universally applicable. Okay. So please focus on these small, small things, because they are going to be a part of your basic understanding of transformations. Okay. Anyways, so going back to our sheet. So A basically, as I told you, decides your concavity. Okay. So B basically, you know, moves the graph or moves the parabola in a parabolic path. And this path equation is what I have asked you for homework. And C basically makes the parabola move up and down. Moves the parabola up and down. Okay. Up and down. Okay. Now, let us start understanding a bit of transformations from here on. So, please note this down, because I'll be going to the next page. And anybody has any question, do let me know. The class will exactly end at 6 o'clock. So we have roughly 25 minutes for the class to end. Okay. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Good. Good. You reminded me, Setu, else I would have moved on. Yeah. So see, Setu, just focus on. Okay. I'll just reopen the graph once again. That was too muddled up. So I thought I would, you know, start with a new one. Okay, so first of all, I will keep a parameter over here. Let's say I keep a parameter A, which goes from minus 10 to, let's say, plus 10. Okay. And I write a quadratic y is equal to ax square plus x plus 1. Okay, just a simple quadratic I have. Okay, now see, Setu. If I start taking my A to the negative side, okay, first of all, it inverts, it becomes a downward opening parabola. If I keep going more negative, see, starts shrinking. You see that? Higher the negative value, that means higher in magnitude, I make the value of A, more shrunk is the graph, but it is opening downward because it has a negative value attached to it. Right? Is this what you wanted to see? Does this satisfy your question? Okay. All right. So now we are heading towards some transformations. So let's talk about transformations. By the way, I'm basically using our parabola to showcase you these transformations, but these are universally applicable transformations. Okay. Adya has a question. Oh, very good question. When does the parabola open leftward or rightward? Okay, we'll talk about this, Adya, but just to give you an idea, if you replace your positions of X and Y, the parabola will start opening leftward or rightward. For example, let's say this was the parabola which you just saw, it was opening upwards, right? Okay. If you want it to open rightward, just swap the positions of X and Y. This parabola will open rightwards like this. Okay, I'll talk about this also, because this is also one of the transformations that is required for us. Why does it happen? That's a story which is to be taken, you know, in after a few classes. Okay, so just to answer your question, when does the parabola open rightwards or leftwards? I'll talk about leftward. Leftward basically it opens when you are changing your x sign to minus x. Okay, so if you make it as minus x equal to y square, it would become a parabola which is opening leftward like this. Okay. Why does it happen? We'll talk about it some other day. All right. So let us talk about few transformations. So the first transformation that I would like you to understand is by this simple example. Let's say I have a very basic standard parabola y equal to x square. Okay, so such parabolas are mainly called standard parabola. Why they are called standard parabola? Because they are very, very simplistic case of a parabola. Parabola can have a very complicated equation also. I will not go into details of that, because anyways a chapter is going to come up for you in class 11. So as of now, I'm going to start with a simplistic case of a parabola, which we call as a standard parabola. We already have seen this type of parabola in our GeoGebra graph. It's an upward opening parabola like this. Okay. I've tried my best to draw a smooth one. Okay. Now my question to all of you is, instead of this, if I ask you to draw the graph of y equal to x minus 1 whole square, how would you draw it? Of course, you'll say, sir, I'll sit and plot. Okay, I'll put some value of x and I'll see the value of y, and that x comma y I will plot. Okay, now that is fine for the initial learning, but soon you will see a pattern developing in these kind of questions. So see, everybody, please pay attention. So in order to know the graph of this, let's do some plotting. If I put my value of x as 1, my y value will be 0, correct? So this graph will be passing through 1 comma 0. Let's say it is over here. Okay. If I put my value of x as 2, my y value will be 1. So it will be passing through 2 comma 1. And at the same time, if I put minus, or if I put 0 also, it is again going to pass through 1. So it is going to pass through 0 comma 1 also. Okay. So this is my x axis. This is my y axis, even though I've not written it. Okay. Let's further pick up few more points. Let's say if I put 3, it will pass through 3 comma 4. So 3 comma 4 will be somewhere over here. And if I put minus 1 also, it will pass through 4. So minus 1 comma 4 will, minus 1 comma 4 will also lie over here. Okay. Now let us try to join these points and see what has happened to the final graph. There you go. Now can somebody tell me what happened to the white parabola that it became the yellow parabola? In one statement, if you see, what happened to the white parabola that it became the yellow parabola? Absolutely correct. The parabola vertex, in fact, the entire parabola, my dear, not only the vertex, entire parabola. Of course, the vertex shifted. Every point started shifting one unit to the right. As you can see, every point started making a migration of one unit to the right. Okay. So this is a very interesting phenomena, which we call as the horizontal shift. Okay. So this is a phenomena, or this is a rule which we call as the rule of horizontal shift. So what is this rule? This rule says that if you are basically given any graph, let's say you are given a graph of this. So let's say I write it down. Graph is given. Graph is given. Okay. And let's say somebody asks you, the graph of y is equal to rx minus h, h being some positive quantity, let's say for the sake of discussion over here. So something like here, what happened? So if you have been given the graph of y is equal to x square, so compare this with this guy, and you're asked the graph of this, okay, compare this with this guy, okay, then you don't have to reinvent the wheel, you don't have to sit and plot, you know, like the way I did initially. You just have to take this graph, okay? So this graph can be obtained by shifting the graph of this by h units to the right. By h units to the right. Or let me make an arrow diagram so that it is clear in your memory. Are you getting my point? And let me tell you, it's a general rule. It's a universal rule. It is not just, you know, a subject matter of a parabola. You can apply it to straight lines also, right? You can apply it to trigonometric curves also, trigonometric graphs also. You can apply it to exponential graphs also, logarithmic graphs also, any special function graph also. Okay. So this is something which is a rule which can be followed by any relation graph, any relation graph. Okay. That's why I wrote an R over here, just to show that it is applicable for any relation. Okay, not primarily or not particularly a parabola only. Are you getting my point? So let's say if I extend this further and ask you, if I want to know the graph of y is equal to x minus 2 the whole square, what will happen? Now you are very clear that it will further shift one unit like this. So it will become tuck like this. Okay, so now its vertex will come to 2,0 position. So earlier it was 1,0, and initially the beginning of the graph was at 0,0. Okay, are you getting this point? Okay, Adya has a question. Sorry, Nidhi has a question. Sir, doesn't negative mean left? Okay, yes. Now this is a confusion that people have. You are very correct, Nidhi. Negative means left. But actually, what is happening here? The origin gets shifted to the left. That is why the graph seems to move to the right. So there is a small story behind it, which I have not told you right now, primarily because you people are not that mature enough to take it right now. There's a concept called shift of origin. Okay. In shift of origin, when you replace your x with x minus h, origin gets shifted h units to the left. Now, because origin gets shifted to the left, the graph appears to shift to the right. Are you getting a point? That's why these curves, they appear to move to the right, but it is actually not the graph which moves, my dear. It's the origin which is moving to the left. See, it's like, how can I make you away from me? Either I push you or I go myself back. Then only you will be away from me, correct? So here, origin is what doing? Origin is stepping back. Yeah. So to answer your question, Adya, origin is moving, and Nidhi as well, the origin is moving h units to the left, and hence the graph appears to move h units to the right. But my serious suggestion to you would be, do not as of now mix these two concepts, because you will get confused. Okay, so follow one simple rule. The rule is, in your graph, if you are replacing your x, mark my words, in any relation equation, if you are replacing your x with x minus h, h being a positive quantity, you are going to shift the graph h units to the right, period. Okay, yes. So Shardulli, if your h was a negative quantity, your graph will shift to the left. If h was a positive quantity, your graph, so let me write that down also. So I don't want to just speak in the air, I want to just write it down. And if you want the graph of y is equal to a relation in x plus h, that means you are replacing this x with x plus h now, the graph will be shifting shifting. So shift this graph by h units to the left. Okay, let me show you how. So I'll again restart the whole thing. So all of you please pay attention, okay? So y is equal to x minus, I'm just taking a parameter a which I'm going to change. So as of now, it has taken a value as 1 and they have plotted y equal to x minus 1 the whole square. As you can see, x minus 1 the whole square is shifted 1 unit to the right from this position. So let's say I put it 0. Okay. So if I keep increasing this to, let's say I take x minus 1, it has moved 1 unit to the right, minus 2, again moving, okay, minus 3, again moving, minus 4, okay. So as I keep changing this value, as I keep changing this value of a, it starts moving to the right because I have kept it as x minus something, x minus a, okay. If I change it to, let's say, a value like this, x plus 1, okay, let's say this is your x squared, okay. Now, x plus 1, you see it is moving left, x plus 2 further left, x plus 3 further left, x plus 4 further left, like that, okay. So, this is the two rules which we call as the horizontal shift rule. And the main reason behind these rules is the shifting of the origin, which is something which I'm going to talk about in your coordinate geometry chapter, not right now. Is the idea clear? Okay, now just to give you a clearer idea in that case, you can just think of it like this. If you have a curve y is equal to r minus h, okay, and if h is positive, the graph will shift to the right, and if h is negative, the graph will shift to the left. Does it now satisfy your concern, Setu? Okay, this is just for your, you can note this down for your overall understanding. Sir, are you going to give questions about this horizontal shift rule? Yes, of course, you are going to take a question, a very small question I will be taking up. So first, everybody make a note of this rule. Okay. Any question, any concerns, please feel free to highlight. Here also, I'm assuming H to be positive. Guys, just keep a simple thing in your mind. If X minus something is happening, take the graph to the right. X plus something is happening, I mean, X plus a positive number is happening, take the graph to the left. So as somebody rightly said, it is working in reverse psychology. Ulta, it is working ulta. So minus it is going right, positive it is going left. Simple as that. Okay. So a very small question we'll take up on this. Very, very small question. Which of the following is the graph of y is equal to x plus 2 the whole square? Which of the following is the graph of y equal to x plus 2 the whole square? Please put your response on the poll which has been launched. Very good. I've started getting the right answer. Awesome. I hope nobody gets confused here. Awesome. Very good. Good, Shardili. Good. Okay. Almost everybody has responded. So let me do a countdown. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Everybody, please vote. Please vote. Come on, guys and girls. You can do it. Okay. So I received votes from 14 of you, and this is what 14 of you have to say, option A. So everybody is concurrent on the fact that it has to be option A, which is absolutely correct. Okay. So as I told you, x plus 2 means 2 units to the left. Okay. Now just to write down what are these graphs, okay. This guy is actually y equal to x minus 2 the whole square. As you can see, it has moved 2 units to the right. Okay. We'll talk about C and D now, actually, because C and D basically involve vertical shifts. So let's talk about vertical shifts now. Okay. Now, the very same example I will take now, start with now. Y equal to x square. Y equal to x square is a graph like this. Okay, everybody knows it. Okay. Please forgive me if I don't write x and y because it's understood more or less. Okay. Now, my question is, how would I draw the graph of y equal to x square? Or let me write it like this. How would you draw the graph of y minus 1 is equal to x square? Or in other words, how would you draw the graph of y is equal to x square plus 1? Okay. Now, initially, when we do not know, we will actually try to plot. So if I put x as 0, y will be 1. So it will pass through 0, 1. When I put x as 1, y will be 2. So y will be here, 0, 1, 2. When I put x as 2, y will be 5. So it will go jump almost here. Okay. Similarly, for minus 1 also, it will give me 2. Okay. And for minus 2, it will give me 5. Okay. Now, what do you see here? If you start connecting these dots, they tell you something very interesting. They tell you that the graph has actually moved one unit up. That means every point on the graph has been kicked up. Okay, you take a point and you just kick it up. So every point has been kicked up by, you know, one unit up. Okay, not this one. This is too big a kick. Okay, so what has happened? The value of y for every corresponding point has become more than one or become incremented by one. So this is what we call as a vertical shift. Are you getting my point? This is called a vertical shift. Okay. So here is a rule that comes, which everybody should note down. Okay. Vertical shift rule. Vertical shift rule says, if you have been given the graph of a relation like this, okay, let's say this graph is given. Okay, this graph is given. Okay. And somebody comes to you and say, hey, can you draw the graph of this kind of a equation? Then all you have to do is you have to shift the graph of this by k units upwards. Now again, the reverse psychology is working. Y minus something means upward. Okay. And if somebody says draw the graph of y plus k equal to something, then you have to shift this graph k units downwards. Are you getting my point? Okay. So this is what we call as the rule of vertical shift. Okay, so we'll go back to that question which we had, you know, taken a little while ago, and we'll try to see the ones which we did not mark, which graphs were they actually. Okay, and then I'll give you a question to end the day. So please note this down, and if you have any question, please fire your questions at me. Done? Okay, let's move on to the previous question. Just for a couple of seconds, we'll discuss about it. In previous question, if you see option number C and D, can somebody tell me what is this graph C representing, or whose graph is C actually? Which equation's graph is C? Yes, K is positive, Nidhi. Sorry, I forgot to tell you that. K is positive there. Yeah. Please write down on your chat box whose graph is C. You cannot see the numbers clearly. Okay, my dear, this is minus 2. Okay, and assume that it was coming from x square graph. Very good. Y plus 2 equal to x square, or you can also say y equal to x square minus 2. Brilliant. You guys are very sharp. Okay. Now, D for D. Tell me for D. Very good, Nikita. Very good. Everybody has given the right answer. God bless you guys. Very good. All right. Now, can there be a question where there is both vertical and horizontal shift happening? Yes, it is quite possible that we can get a function or get a relation where both the shifts are taking place. So to wrap up this session, I would like you to solve this question for me. A very simple one. Which of the following is the graph of y is equal to x minus 1 whole square plus 3? Okay, think carefully. I'm giving you 2 minutes. We have 2 minutes to 6. So think carefully and then answer. Don't rush. I'm launching the poll. And once you're convinced, press on the poll button, whichever option you think is correct. Aram se, no need to hurry. Don't rush. These are just our initial understandings of the concepts. So here and there, if something goes wrong, you will keep on making mistakes. So here is a mix of the two shiftings. Here's a mix of the two shiftings. Very good, Janta. Janta is smart. Nice. Sir, why are you smiling so much, sir? Are we going wrong somewhere? Okay, so one person has is differing from other people. Let's see. Five of you still to vote. Come on, guys and girls. Last 30 seconds. So for the three people who have still not voted, 30 seconds is all I can give you. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, all 17 of you have voted. Very good. Maximum Janta goes for C for Chennai, and you are absolutely right. I'll tell you that, Setu, in some time. Okay, now see here, if you start building this graph, you start from the standard one. Okay, so normally when we are going to a complicated expression, we start our journey from a simpler one. It's like, you are adding a flesh to the skeleton, and then you are adding, let's say, organs to it, and then you are adding skin to it, and finally you are making a human body. So you start with a skeleton and see what all changes can you make in order to finally reach this stage. Okay. So first, as you can see from your observation, it is x minus 1 the whole square. So you are replacing your x with x minus 1, right? The moment you do that, I'll just take you through the stages. So the moment you do that, initially it was like this. The moment you replace your x with x minus 1 the whole square, I should have written it in white actually, but anyways, your graph gets shifted one unit to the right, like this. Okay, just one unit, yeah, to the right. Okay, now I want to get this 3 over here. So how will I get that 3? You say, sir, simple, change your y with y minus 3. Okay, the moment I do that, automatically this minus 3 will come on the other side to become a plus 3, right? So when you change in your any equation, if you change your y with y minus 3, it basically goes 3 units up, isn't it? So this graph, white graph, will now go 3 units up. That means it will be like this in the air. Okay. In other words, the vertex will come at 1, 3. So whichever option says your vertex is at 1, 3, that will be your right option. And of course, it should be opening upwards. This cannot be my option because the vertex seems to be at -1, 3. This cannot be your option because the vertex seems to be at 1, -3. This is your option, my dear friend, which all of you have said. In fact, most of you have said. So C is the right option. And by the way, this also cannot be because here your vertex is at -1, -3. Okay. So option number C is the right option. Well done. Okay. So with this, we close the today's session. I think some of you have a doubt. What is the difference between a quadratic polynomial and a quadratic equation? It's a very big difference. Equation is where you are trying to solve for that particular quadratic polynomial. Let's say I basically give you this, okay? And I basically give you this, okay? So normally this is a quadratic polynomial, okay? Where you are basically replacing this with a y because you want to plot it along the y-axis. Okay, so this entire value of x square minus, so see, every point here is what? It is x comma, let's say I'm assuming that this is this equation only, which is not the case in this case. Okay, so you are basically plotting x comma x square minus 3x plus 2. Let's say, I'm just assuming that this graph is the graph of this quadratic polynomial. But when you say quadratic equation, my dear, basically it is the meeting of this graph. So this thing is basically where do these two graphs actually meet? This and y equal to 0. Are you getting my point? So meeting point of the quadratic polynomial with y equal to 0 basically makes a quadratic equation. Okay. And you're trying to solve this. Now this can be y equal to 0. This can be anything that depends upon whatever number is over here or whatever term is over here. So here you are solving for x to get the value of x for which this meeting will happen. But this is not a meeting kind of a thing. This is basically a relationship between x and y. That's the difference between a polynomial and an equation. Got it, Setu? Is it clear? Okay, Sharduli says, y is negative, which is not possible. Okay, that's also a very smart way to address the problem. Okay. All right.